Buon pomeriggio, benvenuti a quest'ultimo pomeriggio di Incroci di Civiltà. Sta già per finire, comincia ad avere già nostalgia. No, non voglio tirare le lacrime naturalmente. E benvenuti a questo incontro che apre appunto questa ultima parte di Incroci di Civiltà, un incontro che per molti motivi che non ho bisogno di sottolineare. È un incontro speciale, è un incontro importante che, come dire, abbiamo costruito un po' forse all'ultimo minuto, ma ci siamo riusciti. Devo anche ringraziare l'autrice che abbiamo invitato per essere riuscita a venire nonostante i suoi tantissimi impegni. Sto parlando di Oksana Zabuchko, which I hope to pronounce correctly. Probably I'm not going to pronounce correctly, but so and so. I had to learn 22 languages in a week. Questo incontro è un incontro voluto e diciamo programmato insieme al professor Evgeny Dobrenko, che è mio collega del Dipartimento di Studi Linguistici, Letterari e Culturali Comparati, e con il quale qualche tempo fa ci siamo un po' visti, ci siamo un po' parlati, abbiamo detto: beh, come facciamo? Insomma, è grazie a lui che appunto oggi Oksana Zabuchko è qui con noi. L'incontro si svolgerà in lingua inglese e naturalmente ci sarà il preludio della lettura da parte della nostra autrice del brano nella sua lingua, però poi l'incontro proseguirà in lingua inglese. Io mi fermo qui dicendovi, perché può darsi che me lo dimentichi poi alla fine, che alla fine di questa conversazione la nostra scrittrice sarà poi disponibile fuori nel foyer per il consueto firmacopie. So, without further ado, please, Oksana Zabuchko and Evgeny Dobrenko.
Flavio, who said everything about me. I hope it was something nice. Okay, so thank you very much. Molto grazie. Buonasera, good afternoon. And I guess before I start reading, I owe you a couple of opening lines by way of explanation, because I'm going to read from my so far one and only book translated into Italian, which is Fieldwork in Ukrainian Sex, which is okay book. The problem with it being that it's been written in the mid-90s, and last year Ukraine has celebrated the 25th anniversary of its publication. So some certain things, well, we'll discuss. I know Evgeny Dobrenko, some of Evgeny Dobrenko's questions that he wants to ask me here on the stage about this novel. So I'll develop on this maybe a little bit later. But this excerpt, which I'm going to read, belongs to the very end of the book. And for those of you who have not read this novel, I have to explain that this whole Ukrainian sex is happening in America, where my heroine, the protagonist, comes to teach at the American University, and where he brings with her her Ukrainian boyfriend, a painter, and where they have, you know, this traumatic, very toxic relationship, and this whole novel is the monologue of this, angry woman's voice. Well, she's preparing some reading at the university or a lecture or something, and in the same time, in her mind, there is something else, namely the question, how come that the love story that used to start back in Ukraine so beautifully turned out into such a complete failure, traumatic, emotionally, sexually, and everything. So so that's the context, and ladies and gentlemen, she is addressing in her mind to her imaginary Western audience. So that's the kind of a refrain in the book. So that's where you, ladies and gentlemen, are supposed to get turned on, and that's where I start the very final two small excerpts from the finale. Леді джентльмени, ні, наразі тільки леді, точніше, одна леді, донна зі східноєвропейських студій, одна з небагатьох, із ким ти за цей час заприязнилась. Рослява напівірландка, напівслов'янська мішанка, досить приємне для ока поєднання, пшеничне волосся, теплі карі очі, високі вилиці, шкіра притрушена дрібною зерню ластовиння, як добре пропечена булочка кмином. В університетському буфеті, де ви умовилися на ланч, курити заборонено, і донна, допивши з паперового кубка ту гарячу темнобуру рідину, яку американці чомусь називають кавою, тут таки запихає в рота жуйку, сублімація курева. Це намагання в неї виглядає цілком симпатично, може тим, що донна багато і щиро сміється, і від того враження, наче цілий час розсмаковує щось смішне. Дисертацію вона пише про гендер у посткомуністичній політиці. Її не на жарт цікавить, чому в тій політиці не було і нема жінок. Запитання, що незмінно заганяє тебе в глухий кут, скільки б тобі його не ставили західні інтелектуали. Блін, ну звідки мені знати? Здається, Дона підозрює, що тут корінь усіх наших проблем. Як усі феміністки, вона певна, що men are full of shit, і не дає їм волю, починаються тюрми, війни, концтабори, голод, розруха, відключають гарячу воду і електроенергію, а факультету знову урізають кошти на цей рік, і справа з її докторатом затягується. Отож, твою історію Донна бере не те, що до серця, а здається відразу собі до течки. Леді і джентльмени, я продовжую. «Що?» рвучко подається наперед Донна, аж її пшеничні патлі, змитнувшись, спадають у глибокий виріз светра. «Як?» – обурюється Донна. «Як таке може бути? Як взагалі можна так поводитися з живою жінкою?» «О май!» – скрушно кидає головою Донна, з цілком непритаманною їй господарністю, розгладжуючи долонями по стільниці невидиму скатертину. Жест, що видає цілковиту розгубленість, брак коментарів. Ні, вона так. також мала проблеми з своїм останнім бойфрендом, але що б таке? Слухай, каже Донна, і обличчя її погоджується з спокоєм знайденого рішення. Looks like the guy is severely sick, don't you think so? Короткий курс психоаналізу. Шлях до душевного здоров'я. Знайти причину, і проблема зніметься сама собою. Чому досі нікому не спало на думку, що те саме можна проробляти із народами? Пропсихоаналізував гарненько цілу національну історію і попустить як рукою з дня. Література як форма національної терапії. А що? Ну, тебе та ідея. Шкода, що в нас, власне, нема літератури. Одного не розумію, особливо каже Донна. Тут уже явно зачеплено підвалини її світогляду. Я не розумію, чому ти це все терпіла? В ліжкові. Чому відразу не сказала ні? Концептуальний підхід. Боротьба жінок за свої права. Що я можу тобі на це відповісти, доньцю? Що нас ростили мужики, об'єлбані, як тільки можна, з усіх кінців. Що потім такі самі мужики нас трахали, і що в обох випадках вони робили з нами те, що інші, чужі мужики, зробили з ними. І що ми приймали і любили їх такими, як вони є, бо не прийняти їх означало б стати по стороні тих, чужих. Що єдиний наш вибір, отже, Боги залишаються між жертвою і катом, між небуттям і буттям, яке вбиває. Вкинувши до смітті збірні послідки ланчу, пластикові таці з зужитим паперовим начинням, кубками і тарілками в яскравих соусних плямах, соя, кетчуп, гірчиця, сливовий джем, цинобра, кармін, вохра, умбра, як декоративні палітри з театрального реквізиту, місце першої дії – майстерня художника, місце другої дії – квартира в student dorm, третю дію – скасовано з технічних причин, квитки не повертаються, молитви не вислуховуються. Вони пошкують до виходу, Донна штовхає скляні двері, короткий спалах морозного повітря радісно засліплює легені. Крутяться авто, проходять сміючись хлоп'яки в спортивних куртках з емблемою університету. Горить угорі тривожне, електрично-синє небо, і високий, схожий на обкутаного коцом Леонардо да Вінчі в розмаяних сивих космах жебрак на розі, простягає до них пластикову чашку з-під кока-коли, побрязкуючи дріб'язком. «Help homeless man! I'm homeless myself!» Китає вона головою, не до нього, в простір. «А знаєш, – каже раптом Дона, повертаючись до неї, натягаючи автомобільні рукавички і весело жуючи якусь нову думку. Все-таки ці ваші східноєвропейські мужчини, вони, правда, бувають брутальні, але в них, бодай, пристрасті є. А в наших що?» І дивитимешся в ілюмінатор, як повстимуть валізки по стрічці вантажного конвеєра, аби зникнути в черві літака одна по одній. І от уже пливучий пустий проміжок, енергонтажник у форменій кепці з написом USA вскочить у чорне нутро фургончика, і той рушить з місця. А поки ти проводитимеш його поглядом, конвеєр приберуть, натомість на сірому бетоні темнітиме проталина підсихаючої калюжі, все відлунить тобі в голові, як зойк у порожньому храмі. Все, це значить, задрає нолюки. Зараз озветься сухий тріск мікрофона. Леді джентльмени, замуркоче стюардеса, і літак задвихтить, прогріваючи мотори. І то вже буде інша дійсність, інше життя, а гірко скимлячий біль несправдженості до теперішнього. «Катюфе, катюфе, ти та ві», – допитується голос. Звідки сізда такого ближче цій темі? Стільки ж літ, скільки людству, все чого ж чекаєш, мрієш і борсаєшся, сподіваючись на щось попереду, а тоді одного дня виявляється, що то й було життя. Ліпше в тому болові заткатись і не висовуватися більше. Дайте мені мікрофона, і я скажу. Леді джентльмени, ми створили пречудовий світ. І прийміть, будь ласка, з цієї нагоди вітання від USAR, і від CNN, і від CIA, і уругвайської наркомафії, і румунської секурітати, і від ЦК Компартії Китаю, і від мільйонів убивць по всіх тюрмах світу, і десятків мільйонів, що ходять на волі, і від 5 тисяч зачатих гвалтом сараєвських байстрят, що коли-небудь вже повиростають. І зростай, причудовий світ, і от власне і все. Що я хотіла сказати? Дякую за увагу, леді джентльмени. Приємного вам польоту. В юності я мріяла про таку смерть. Авіакатастрофа над Атлантикою. Літак, що розчиняється в небі і морі, ні могили, ні сліда. Тепер я всім серцем вважаю цьому літаку щасливого приземлення. Мені подобається дивитись на високого, жилового старого з горбатим носом і глибоко вритими від очей в тіл борознами, як він запихає в багажний відсік нейлонову торбу з намальованою на пузі тенісною ракеткою. І на іспанисту брюнетку в розхристаному шкіряному пальті, вона з двома малюками. І поки відчепивши від наплічника, примощує в кріслі меншеньке, друге, дівчинка років 5, вузеньке смагляве личко в бароковій рамі, обіцяючи примхливих кучерів, розганяється на всі біч серед проходу засвіченими захватом, оченятами і зубками. Перша подорож і зупиняється на мені. Хай! Щасливо випалює вона. Хай! Кажу я.
You started from the reading of your most famous book, and I must say that this novel was practically first real bestseller in post-Soviet Ukraine. I have a question, probably inevitable one, and again, probably you must be tired of fighting it off. But it's about, of course, autobiographical nature of this novel. But I have to say that my interest in it is not idle, because it seems to me that you are constructing this narrative as clearly autobiographical with a direct purpose of provoking reader, because there is also clear projection of another biography, and this is biography of Lesya Ukrainka. For our audience, I need to explain that Lesya Ukrainka is probably the most prominent and European and in my view most wonderful Ukrainian poets, and clearly number one poetess.
Playwright,
of course, yes, in classical Ukrainian literature. But since everything in your book is provocative, you have these two sort of projections here of autobiographical and biographical sort of angle here. It seems to me that this device, tell me if I'm wrong, that this device has one clear purpose, is to distract the reader from the discourse of Western feminism, which is obviously shocking to, especially, mid-50s, in Ukraine probably was quite shocking for the reader. And the question is, I have to say that it seems to me that not all Ukrainian society was receptive enough and ready to accept the ideas of Western feminism and the degree of openness with which you raise certain topics. So, what was your main reaction? Determination to fight it off or annoyance?
Thank you, Evgeny. It's one of the advantages of being interviewed by a literature professor. They all know better. They all know better than you, and it's really very instructive listening to them, because as an author, of course you don't do things intentionally. You write it's not of course quite spontaneous, it is not of course quite sporadic, but of course you don't have, you know, this business plan when you start, when you plot a novel, when you start writing a novel. Of course, you don't have this business plan in your head in advance, like I'm going to attack this strata of society or that strata of society or whatever else. It is rather than, it is a post-Soviet novel in a way. Though, ironically enough, it proved to be not only post-Soviet, it has survived now. Now it is read by the second generation, and read by the second generation outside of Ukraine as well, which certainly means it has something more in it and about it, and this whole story has something more. Like a day before yesterday, when I was at the Warsaw Book Fair, I've signed the third Polish edition to the guy who happily came up claiming that he was born in 1998. Well, and that's the book that that had impressed him most in his whole reader's life. Well, of course, it is a compliment, so it is not just about, though, in its time, coming to your question, I'm sorry you have to interrupt me, you have to moderate this all, because I am notorious with this, you know, long sentences, and Ukrainian critics have the special term, Zabushko sentence. You know, this one lasting for two or three pages without a full stop, so...
Basically Google sentence.
Well, they say Zabushko sentence, I'm sorry, copyright is mine and I insist, yes. And I speak the same way that I write, with all these digressions and... So coming back to the initial question, yes, this book was, first of all, you know, it's been the grand scandal, the biggest scandal in Ukrainian literature, in the memory, in the living memory, so to speak. And yes, it was claimed the Bible of the Ukrainian feminism, and is being dubbed this way until now, that it is a feminist book, and I've been immediately dubbed as a feminist writer, which I took, you know, as a part of feedback attacking Western feminism. I would say I would say nowadays, 25 years after, it's much easier to explain what I meant in this book, you know, by this kind of satiric flavor appearing in this scene with Donna. Like when you read the letter of this of the German feminist from the 70s, whose name has temporarily eluded me, but you know whom I mean. Well, the lady who's been for her generation, well, that's my parents' generation, who was the guru of German, used to be the guru of German feminism, and who now addresses her government, German government, with the demand not to sell arms to Ukraine because men are full of shit and all the war have been invented by men. So all the wars belong to patriarchy, and that's why you should not, you should stop the war by stopping arming Ukraine. Holy shit! This is the, so to speak, alleged leader of her the alleged feminist leader of her generation now, and in fact, claiming for all this after Bucha, after all the rapes performed upon the Russian occupying army in Ukraine, upon Ukrainian women, rather than standing with the women, rather than speaking in the name of women who always become the, yes, that's true, it's women who become the first prey of the war, and it's women who became the first and immediate prey of the war that Russia started in Ukraine. And where is this voice of Western feminism? Here is this lady who has learned the right words, not from human sympathy, human relation, empathy, all these kind of things, but from textbooks. From textbooks on what is proper feminism, how patriarchy should be treated, how war should be pigeonholed in her own theory. And that's a very good example of how any ideology, whenever taken for granted, becomes the instrument of dehumanization. And I guess that's the answer. It's not my answer. If you were asking me this question 25 years ago, I would have probably been, well, not quite lost, but now, you know, it's history that answered this question and that proved the 25 years ago in this scene with Donna, I was damned right, but I'm not proud with my having been right, and I'm not quite happy with my being right. I would have rather preferred to have been wrong there. It's not fun to be a Cassandra this way, no.
Of your work. So let me turn to this biographical aspect.
Yeah, I'll tell about this. Yeah. Thanks for reminding me.
Yeah. So your family belonged to a prominent Ukrainian intelligence. And your father was repressed in Stalin's time. And, you know, where, you know, there was a period of widespread repressions against the Ukrainian intelligentsia. And then, you know, not only intelligentsia, but, you know, in general, artists, scholars, you know, people with you know, who sort of, you know, were incarnation of national consciousness. So, and then, in post-Stalin's time, your family was again, fled from your native town. So you were against again affected by this. The question is how this sort of first-hand experience of repressions affected your work. And would you agree, in general, with the idea that creativity and creative work in general starts with or being a product of a dissonance?
Well, how much time do we have?
Not much, I have to say.
Well, because that's a question which actually deserves, I don't know, 1 hour lecture to be more or less, not exhausted, but, well, properly answered. Literature is a dissidence, I don't know. In a way, you can say this because, as my agent has it, normal people don't write books. So writing books comes as a certain kind of starts a certain kind of discord with reality. Yeah. Some desire to bring some sense into what looks like a chaos and disorder of life, and yes, you do risk the creator's role, and there is a chapter on this in this very same novel. Well, are we creators, or is it, you know, too ambitious a word to be applied to what people do with when they write books or I don't know, make paintings or, you know, come up to the stage and do some performance or whatever else. Well, but speaking, well, this, I would say that this autobiographical or biographical moment, yes, I did want, you know, this this very book, I mean, Fieldwork in Ukrainian Sex, well, what is, what made it, you know, such a, I think, a part of its effect, emotional effect that it was having on the Ukrainian society, is that I've been then fed off, you know, both with Soviet, post-Soviet, colonial, anti-colonial, post-colonial dogmas, stereotypes, and everything. And like the main emotion, what I was going to tell to the world with this novel then, 25 years ago, was fuck you. So that was this real fuck you. Like, I've had enough. I've had enough of all that. I want to live my own life, and it's been an attempt somehow to make myself heard in this anger, in this pent up cultural anger, so to speak. So I did attack many stereotypes, and yes, I was using this autobiographical material, and yes, using my own biography intentionally, and I gave heroin my own name intentionally, and of course it's been taken immediately, you know, as autobiography. Well, not exactly. It is a trick. Oksana from the book is not exactly myself. And it is not a non-fiction book. It is fictional. It is a novel after all. And yes, it's been because this has been done intentionally. This has been just the way to scream Urbi et Orbi, that yes, that's what I like, ich stehe hier, ich kann nicht anders, you know, that's me, and for every word written in this book, I can, you know, bear responsibility at any, I don't know, any cathedra. Might be naive, might be, I don't know, dubious as a writer's position, as this way to choose a narrator and this way to construct a novel, but it worked then and it still works in a way. It is not an example which I would recommend to follow for the younger writers. It costs you dearly. I mean, I've passed through the gauntlet of the most outrageous criticism, and it is not, it's not an easy experience, you know, for a young woman as I was then. That's something, so I was this, you know, dissident writer in a way. You know, this prose debut, this debut in novel. That was, yes, I kind of challenged the society, and of course, if you challenge the society, of course, it challenges you back, which is pretty normal. It gets split, half of the audience is booing, half of the audience is applauding, and yes, in a way, you know what I've got, I would say, this experience of resistance that I do have inherited from the previous generations of my family, yes, it proved to be helpful. You know how to stand for yourself, you know how to stand for your identity, you know how to stand for what you believe is right. And that's it.
Thank you. My next question is sort of continuation. You've mentioned, you know, because it was about, you know, autobiographical or biographical or fictional, these different aspects. You've mentioned that this is, of course, a novel, and it's a fictional text. But in your non-fiction works, and there are plenty of them, and they are very significant, such as Philosophy of the Ukrainian Idea and the European Context, the Francos period, Shevchenko's Myth of Ukraine, and Notre Dame de Ukraine, Lesya Ukrainka in the Conflict of Mythology. You turn to the concept of myth. Mythology, as we all know, is one of the key elements of national identity. Do you consider these nonfiction works as your contribution to the nation building in Ukraine? Do you see your goal in deconstruction of those myths or in their construction? And this is about non-fictional works, but also fictional works, and I wanted to turn to your book, which will be published in Italian translation very soon, the Museum of Abandoned Secrets, which is in my opinion, is a perfect example of, if one can say, nation building novels. It's sort of not a buildings roman, but nation buildings roman, might say. A national epic, a national history is being created. All is what is described to us by Erich Hobsbawm and Benedict Anderson is clearly there. When you conceived this novel, did you have this sort of non-fictional, but a rather political agenda in mind? Thank you.
No. Of course, when you spend like 7 years of your life writing a grand novel, some 800 pages long, for which you do research and everything, well, of course, it involves different, layers of intentions, motivations, and everything. But it is a part of your life, and it is, you try to cut me as some kind of a political figure or political leader, I don't know, somewhere, some Ukrainian version of female Lenin or whatever. I'm not. I do things that interest me, emotionally, psychologically, existentially, unfortunately, life is too short, and I still have in my mind a long list of books which I would like to write if I were, if I were immortal, or if I were having 50 years in front of me, which I don't have anymore. To answer your question briefly, or as briefly as I can, it's a kind of a strange advantage to have been born within a culture which for the whole past century has been forcefully pushed into silence, into non-existence, and which therefore has accumulated about three generations of the most dramatic and traumatic experience, the huge amount of stories to be told, which were never told, and to start with the Great Famine of the 1933, when I was a schoolgirl back in the 70s, it was still banned to pronounce in public something about the famine of the 1933 was man-made, and there were still people who were, sent to prison for that. So it's quite recent, and this forced silence, this imposed silence, the culture under the burden of silence, and with this feeling, having been born and growing up, with this feeling of like, oh goodness, so many things to be told. So many things to be told, and they are multiplying. And now with this war, you know, bringing more and more stories all every day, well, then you understand, you know, well, that's like the infinity of work for a writer. So basically what I've been doing through my literary career, be it in fiction or non-fiction, can be summarized as an attempt to speak for those who could not do it in their time, to fill in the gaps in culture made by the silence of the victims, so to speak. And except for the silence of the victims, there are other zones of silence, like the shame of witnesses. It also produces silence. The fear of murderers also produces silence. So we have lots of these lacunes in the past. And that's why the past tends to repeat itself. That's what I do believe. That whenever we miss something, whenever we remain something important untold, unarticulated, underarticulated, and I'll put it under the carpet and try not to notice it. Well, then history at some turn will bring us back to the same place and will make us to learn the question that we wanted to miss. So I deal with all the time. It was not, you know, intentional. It was not a, you know, any like program for lifetime, for decades or something like this, for the whole literary career. But that's something that I see now, looking back and trying to answer your question. As the strongest, you know, motivation that have been driving me through all those 20-something books, oh my God, that I've written so far.
Thank you. And probably my last question is following. And it's again about the Museum of Abandoned Secrets. It has been called an epic by critics and compared to Thomas Mann's family novel and compared to Emile Zola.
Not Zola, please, no thank you. I think I'm better.
Well, not all French specialists would agree with that, and of course in a Russian tradition from War and Peace to Life and Fate, as you know, in Soviet literature and including both in Ukrainian literature as well, of course. Ukrainian Soviet literature. This epic novel, which describes the life of several generations of one family against the backdrop of dramatic historical and tragic historical changes, was also dominating. It was a super genre, the so-called panoramic novel. Do you associate your novel with any of these traditions? We all know about Emile Zola, so we won't touch that, but the rest. And also, if so, Which one, I mean, among those traditions you find important and why? Also, my second question in this sort of about this novel, you build a parallel historical narrative with the main points there is Holodomor, Ukrainian insurgent army, and Orange Revolution. This narrative, in fact, is rather tragic. Because all its main points are, let's be honest, either tragedies or failed alternatives in 20th century and 21st century Ukrainian history. I say parallel because it is clearly built as a counter-narrative to the Soviet narrative. Again, was it conscious choice of the point of departure, or
not?
I know.
Well, you know what? That's extremely interesting. You know, it is like you are talking about somebody else's work, because I never. No, that's exciting when you learn something about your own work that you never suspected was there. Well, that's precisely what you need good critics for. This kind of exchange, like, oh, really? Everything about literature is interpretation. Every book has so many versions as it has readers. You have your prospect. I was having mine. I was having two sisters. I hate to give you spoilers. This book, this novel, which got lots of prizes, lots of international prizes, and in some countries have been called one of the most important Central European novels that appeared since 1989 and blah, blah, blah. So it's going to appear in Italian next year. What are we doing now is spoiling in the most shameful and blatant way. But by way of spoiling, by way of giving you spoilers, I can say, answering your question, Evgeny, that for me it is about women making actually a proletariat of history, of this secret role of women in that unseen role of women in the 20th century history, of course in Ukrainian history, because that's the one I know best and which is known the least, and of course it is always most interesting for a writer to write about what is less known and what is underexplored in literature. So it is about the story, how it is like two different models, yes, two sisters and two different lines of behavior, two different lives, two different lines, to different versions, to different paradigms of surviving in history or making history, of female ways of making history. The problem with this novel is that it is only, you have to read it all through, to make it all through. Because it has a very complex, forget Zola, I mean, it has a very complex structure. It is told Well, there are three voices. It has three narrators, one from the 40s, Anyway, so different voices being intertwined, and it's only in the very end that you see how all these people are related, and the characters don't know this, and it is the reader who sees the entity in the very end. And that's why I would say that I rather connect in my mind this novel with the tradition of the 20th century. I love Vasily Grossman's Life and Fate dearly, absolutely. I think it's maybe it's well the best Russian novel of the 20th century. But in this case, I would say, in the case of the Museum of Abandoned Secret, that was Faulkner's The Sound and the Fury, the same story told by four different narrators, and the discovery that the story told by four different narrators gives us four different stories. That's the end of the classical physics, when the object depends on the observer, observing person, on the observer, yeah. And maybe Alexandria quartet. Alexandria quartet. Louis Dalloway. Alexandria quartet, this wonderful British novel. Again, you know, it's the same like four characters, and each part told from different character, changing narrators and everything. I really appreciate that. You know, I appreciate this change of. I love writing not epics. I mean, you know, the classical novel of the 19th, in the classical novel of the 19th century, an author was in a position of all-knowing God. While the 20th century has made us, I would say, less ambitious with this regard, and I like writing not what happened. I like writing about how what happened has been taken by my characters. I like this inner prospect. I like getting under the skin of every character, and it makes it closer sometimes, maybe to the poetical approach, to the lyrical approach, than to the epical one. But in fact, it is the same, I would say, changing philosophy of a novel. Which has something to do with the age of Einstein and with the end of the classical physics too. Yes, we are, we have to finish. Did I get it right?
It's about this novel.
It's about this novel.
All right.
Oh goodness, okay. You have shut me down because these Zabushko sentences are going to last into infinity if you are not stopping me.
Mm. So any sentence should stop somewhere. We just take watches, look at this, say okay. It's hour of your attention. And thank you very much, Oksana, for your wonderful presentation and for your readings and for answering these questions. And thanks everybody for coming and attending this event. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Actually, that was not a way of cutting your story short, because it was just a suggestion for him about the novel that you were mentioning, Alexandra Poetet by Lawrence Durrell, four volumes, 1956.
Lawrence Durrell, yeah.
And that's what she was saying, that her model, if there is any model, is rather Durrell than 19th century epic, I understand. May I have the question myself? I take 5 minutes, I mean, 2 minutes. Talking of models, I mean, all the writers you mentioned, or Gaming mentioned so far, are male writers. You mentioned, I think, you had the Buddenbrock in mind, and then Grossman, and then Durrell. Maybe any women writer, for this kind of, you refuse the epic as a definition, but you know, as for this. Encompassing and engulfing history. Do you have any?
Yeah, thank you very much for this question. Well, you've touched a sore spot, because, of course, I do have an immediate predecessor in Ukrainian literature, but since you don't know anything about Ukrainian literature, you don't have even contemporary writers translated, well, presented in Italian. Of course, you don't know my mother figures, you don't know my role models, you don't know the great Ukrainian women authors from the 20th century, not even Lesya Ukrainka on the stage. Though without Lesya Ukrainka's place, European theatre and European literature of the 20th century will never be complete. Absolutely, she's one of the greatest, and she's been one of the greatest, revolutionary women writers, changing, absolutely changing, having been ahead of time for half a century or something. And of course, since you don't know Lesya Ukrainka, who is the only woman that made it on the Ukrainian money. Well, quite a career for a woman, quite a career for a woman writer. Well, of course, you would not know Irina Wilde, whose tetralogy, 4 volumes, called Sisters Rychinsky, a family saga, about, from the Galician province of the 30s, showing this vanishing European Belle Epoque in this small provincial Galician town, in the family of a priest, of a Greek Catholic priest, fathering 5 daughters. He dies all of a sudden on a stroke. And here is a widow and 5 daughters who are totally and completely unprepared to deal with the reality on their own, and how the whole history of this pre-war Europe can appear on this everyday level of life of 5 women completely lost in history, but trying somehow to cope with life. And yes, it's an amazing device, an amazing writer's technique to make an epic on from this, very woman's, very female standpoint. It's not Jane Austen. It's not Jane Austen. They are not just sitting and talking. No, they are trying to act. Five characters, five female characters, trying to act in this pre-war Galician province. And how you see in four volumes, and how you see this whole pre-war Europe, very female and very, I mean, as a teenager, you know, I've been devouring it, even though, you know, I was not encouraged by my parents because it was like premature readings, there were all those sexual scenes and sexual experience and everything. It's a great novel, it's a great woman's novel, it's a great Ukrainian novel, which had been underestimated in Ukraine as well. Okay, women, you know, we celebrate men who were writing about the World War II, but women who write about, something, what it is all about after all, yeah? So it really takes time somehow to reevaluate the past and then if after my Museum of Abandoned Secrets someone will translate into Italian Irina Wilde, that will be good.
That's a great piece of advice for publishers. If there's any publisher here, please pick the piece of advice. And thank you very much, Oksana, for your
Thank you. Thank you for this question.